Hi, and welcome back to another episode of Leaving the Farm right here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps. We are a listener-supported radio station, where, and if you'd like to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages, join us in chat, have fun, visit our store. Also, we're simulcasting on No Borders Radio at noBordersRadio.co.uk in the UK, as well as TammyPeckerman.org, where you can find the No Borders Radio player. If you'd like to donate to keep us on the net and on the air, please do so by clicking on the donate button at TammyPeckerman.org, which goes to TamworthWebDevelopment.co.uk. Wow, Governor Pilot, Rick Perry has been indicted by grand jury for criminal coercion when his office, part of his office, wanted to investigate corruption within it. He said, no. If you do that, I'm going to take away the funding. And of course, lo and behold, prosecuting attorney, district attorney that wanted to do so, was picked up for a DUI. Coincidence? No. Rick Perry is traded on Dun & Bradstreet as the general counsel. He is the director. Oddly enough, he's been considered and compared to Andrew Cuomo, who just did the same thing in New York. That governor there sent out a subpoena regarding corrupt activity, found out it was in his own office, and says, oh, oops, sorry about that. My, we don't want to do that, do we? Pardon my mistake. No, wait a second here. You found out that you're corrupt, and this was exposed to humanity, the former constituents and, excuse me, buyers of the concepts that you provide them whilst raising them to the ground. You're not going to get away with these things. You know, we can put on as many shows as we want to, and we can blame the cops, and we can blame blacks and whites and reds and yellows and Christians and Jews. We can blame atheists and point the finger at everyone else except for Governor Pilot and his crew, the chief priests and elders. We can do that. If that's what everybody's choice is, to live as Job, to live as Jesus, to perpetually hang on that cross, we can do that. We can forgive them. We can let this go. Governor Perry there, general counsel, is also traded as the Department of Health and Human Services, which is the Office of Population Affairs created by Henry Kissinger in 1975 as a depopulation program. Texas is a child trafficking hub. It's where the world goes round. Children go in and out of Child Protective Services, Department of Health and Human Services. Females go in and out of Department of Health and Human Services, offered so many things through Winning Hearts and Minds, a war tactic, giving her candy like Chester the Molester, driving around in a car. Come on, baby. You know you want this movie night down at the local church. You know you want your kids to be down here at the local community center where all the pedophiles congregate, take pictures of them. You know you want your children to be trafficked by predators, right? I mean, we want the easy way. We don't want to hold Governor Cuomo accountable and Governor Rick Perry accountable for their works. We don't want the priests to all go away so that our children will be safe from predation, right? We want to hang Jesus on that cross. We don't want to take Barabbas. I mean, it's not economically feasible if we take Barabbas, right? No, wrong. Taking Barabbas, Barabbas has great credit. Attorneys have great credit. They've been living high on the hog. They've got nice big houses and nice cars, cushy, cushy office buildings, banks, beautiful credit. Their Moody's scores of these corporations are really great. They've got great credit. Isn't it better business? More efficient for humanity to put Barabbas or the corporate entities on that cross? I mean, in the 14th Amendment, the Attorney in Chief, President Abraham Lincoln, gave life to the corporation over humanity. He says, well, we're going to call it a person, and it's going to be life insured, and we're going to make sure that it is maintained on corporate welfare the rest of its existence. Well, how do we do that? Well, here's the downside. We're going to have to give Stasi agents all whips and the authority to arrest human beings and torture tactics, legal tactics and maneuvers by which we can make the slaves produce for those corporations. We're going to play Spartacus, and we're going to pit them against each other, call them black and white and boys and girls and males and females and Christian and Jew, and we're going to cash in on those things because, you know, that's great. Good business for those chief priests and elders. Great business for those chief priests and elders who love nothing more than to prey on your children. Great business. Human trafficking. Drugging of a populace. Slaughter of a populace through very, very soft measures. The prescription industry. Very soft measures. 42 females per day in the United States Incorporated are dying of prescription overdose. And when you look at the written prescriptions, they're already in the amounts that shut down the lungs, shut down the bodily functions. It's not overdose. It's a depopulation program aimed at targeting females. Well, why is that? Well, we have a divorce industry, 80% divorce rate. And if we specialize those females and give them lots and lots of title, what they're going to do is they're going to falsely accuse the male and move him away from protecting the babies. After we do that, we're going to take her out through the medical industry. 42 females per day in the United States Incorporated alone are being slaughtered in this genocidal play. Those children that are restrained from their fathers and are now orphaned by their dead mothers will enter into Rick Perry and his cronies' child sex trafficking industry. The females that are not murdered, there's some really nasty ones out there, and they're psychopathic. And according to the first and second welfare theorem, they'll trade their kids for drugs or for glory. or for an ego stroke, or for a better life. You give them enough money and they'll let those kids go. Yeah, if I was Rick Perry, I would have done anything in my power to stop the flow of information. However, he's already known for his works and actions. This just brought everything to a head. This week, you know, the New York Times did a really nice piece on, the headline reads, "A youth, an officer, and two paths to a fatal encounter. Ferguson, Missouri. Michael Brown let his 16th birthday come and go without bothering to apply for a driver's license. There was no need, his family said. He preferred to walk. In Ferguson, where Mr. Brown was living with his grandmother, he walked nearly everywhere. On Canfield Drive, where his grandmother kept a small apartment, and several blocks away on the bustling commercial strip of West Florissant Avenue, a four-lane road full of hair salons and cheap restaurants that is the de facto downtown of the neighborhood. It was during one of Mr. Brown's walks down Canfield Drive 1 week ago when he would have an unlikely collision. It involved Mr. Brown, a black teenager who seemed to have avoided most of the traps that dragged down many of his peers, and a white police officer, Darren Wilson, with an admirable record. When it was over, Mr. Brown was dead, and Officer Wilson was facing an uncertain legal and professional future. Chief Thomas Jackson of the Ferguson Police Department, at a hastily called news conference on Friday morning, revealed Officer Wilson's name for the first time. He has been a police officer for 6 years, but Chief Jackson offered scant information about his life and work. Officer Wilson, 28, who has roots in Texas, has worked for 4 years in Ferguson, an inner ring suburb that has the feel of a place in transition. One business strip has been spruced up with a historic Main Street feel, with cheerful painted signs, a wine bar, and a frame shop. The neighborhood where Mr. Brown died is a less appealing pocket of town. A two-bedroom apartment in his grandmother's building goes for about $550 a month. Before that, Officer Wilson worked 2 years in the police department in Jennings, a neighboring suburb. He lives half an hour away in a town of Crestwood, southwest of St. Louis, interviews and property records show. About 6 months ago, neighbors said Officer Wilson moved into a new house, a fixed-up ranch, with a small pool in the back and a wicker love seat on the porch. The mailbox rises from a tub of flowers, and letters on red, white, and blue stars hung from the door spell out welcome. Records indicate that he was divorced last year and now lives with Barbara Spradling, also a police officer who has received an award for valor. The two rarely mix with neighbors or struck up casual conversation, neighbors said. Two middle-aged women sat across the street from Officer Wilson's home on Friday. One, who gave her name only as Kathy, was visiting her 93-year-old grandmother, who bought the house when it was built in 1958. Quote, "All of the neighbors will tell the same story," she said. Quote, "People would just see him and wave, and that's it," end quote. Officer Wilson's professional record suggests someone who has avoided trouble. "There's been no disciplinary action taken against him," Chief Jackson said Friday. Quote, "I've known the officers for years and have every confidence in him," end quote, Chief Jackson said. Officer Wilson received a commendation for, quote, "extraordinary effort in the line of duty" in February. Greg Coppola, lawyer for the union representing Ferguson police officers, confirmed the commendation that Officer Wilson received, but he declined to provide information about what kind of person the officer is or any details about his life. One neighbor said he knew Officer Wilson was on the Ferguson police force and figured out that he might be linked to the shooting of Mr. Brown when police cars marked and unmarked started showing up in the neighborhood several days ago. Then on Tuesday, Officer Wilson began mowing his lawn, but, quote, "he did not finish," end quote, said the neighbor, who wore a faded Cardinals t-shirt and camouflage shorts. Quote, "it appears they left in a hurry," end quote. Quote, "I don't expect them to return," the neighbor said. Rongorski, who lives on the block and was walking his English bulldog, Darla, told reporters that he did not know Officer Wilson, but that his 15-year-old grandson and his friends were allowed to swim in the officer's pool. Quote, when he finds out all this happened, he'll be shocked, end quote, Mr. Gorski said. He said Mr. Wilson cleared out days ago, but we knew something was going on because police were going up and down the block for a few days now, end quote. 20 miles away in Ferguson, the Brown family said it was no closer to understanding the circumstances that led an unarmed 18-year-old to be shot to death by a police officer in the middle of the day. They were outraged that the Ferguson police on Friday released a surveillance video and photos of Mr. Brown apparently stealing cigarillos from a convenience store on West Florissant and shoving a clerk as he walked out. Quote, whatever happened in the store is irrelevant, said Benjamin L. Crump, a lawyer for the family. He added, they're not trying to solve the murder, they're trying to justify it. The family insisted that Mr. Brown had no history of violence or aggression. He had no adult arrest record, according to the police, who said they could not speak to whether he had been arrested as a juvenile. Doesn't matter. We're not going to dehumanize here. Administrators at the chaotic public high school he attended, one of the worst in the state, said he was quiet, shy, and a little awkward, hardly one of the, quote, trouble kids, end quote, of which were plenty. You'd sit in a house with him watching TV and hanging out, and you'd forget he was there, said Tim Snead, 23, a close friend and neighbor. Quote, he had not one enemy. Never heard of him getting in one fight, end quote. Mr. Brown was still a teenager. He smoked marijuana with friends in the neighborhood, they recalled, and drank cans of Bud Light with them when he ducked away from the watchful eyes of his family. Finishing high school was an effort that required the push of his parents and extended family, who scolded him on the days that he slept late, and missed morning classes. But he was determined to avoid many of the missteps frequently taken by his peers. Quote, he wasn't like all these cats out here selling drugs and having babies with different women, end quote. Kathy Gary, 22, a relative, said earlier this week, quote, we tried so hard to keep him in school. Sometimes he'd skip classes and he needed a push, but he wanted to do something, end quote. Last Saturday, the day Mr. Brown died, dawned sunny and warm, around 80 degrees, a typically hot August day in Missouri. With a friend, Dorian Johnson, Mr. Brown set out to West Florissant wearing a white t-shirt, khaki shorts, and a red Cardinals cap. About 10 minutes before noon, they entered Ferguson Market and Liquor, a rundown store with shelves lined with potato chips, Boone's Farm wine, and tequila. Mr. Brown, who was 6'4", has an intimidating appearance. His friends nicknamed him Bodyguard because he was so tall. At 11:51 a.m., the police said someone called 911 to report a robbery. After leaving Ferguson Market, Mr. Brown and Mr. Johnson walked north on West Florissant, passing a McDonald's, a hair braiding shop, and a Chinese restaurant. They turned right at the corner of Canfield Drive, where a fence in the corner at the corner bears a sign, quote, we are watching to report suspicious activities or persons to Ferguson Police Department, end quote. Several blocks later, at 12:01 p.m., they were confronted by Officer Wilson. While they continued down Canfield, a quiet street that curves gently as it weaves through apartment buildings and one-story brick houses. They were stopped not because the police were looking for a robbery suspect, Chief Jackson said Friday, but, quote, because they were walking down the street blocking traffic, end quote. Devin Stone, 28, a friend of Mr. Brown's, was home in his apartment at the time across the street from the place where the men were confronted by the police. Sitting outside his building, Mr. Stone said he was jolted by the sound of two gunshots, followed by several more in rapid succession. The second series of shots sounded automatic, he said. Quote, they let it rip. End quote. Mr. Stone ran outside and saw two police officers, both white men, standing near Mr. Brown, who was lying on his stomach, his arms at his sides, blood seeping from his head. Another neighbor, a woman who identified herself as a nurse, was begging the officers to let her perform CPR. They refused, Mr. Stone said, adding, quote, they didn't even check to see if he was breathing, end quote. On Friday, speaking to reporters, Chief Jackson said the shooting was absolutely devastating to Officer Wilson. He never intended for any of this to happen. Well, what did he intend? What was dispatch whispering in his ear? What was a psychiatrist telling him? What was being promoted by the psychiatrists and corporate counsel and general counsel in that area to make law enforcement fear innocent children? Children, black, red, yellow, white. Who's promoting this aggressive behavior by promoting and indoctrinating fear into the masses? Now, recently we watched that case out of Michigan, where that man had shot the female that had been in an accident that arrived on his porch out of fear. Out of fear. Now, of course, the Gelnhausen Charter says everybody forgets what's going on anyway. They have a very short attention span. But I'll tell you, I was there. We were reporting on these incidences just around the time of the shooting. There was so much fear in Detroit. Crime rate was high. Everybody, all the media was up in arms against the citizenship and cops alike, citizenry and cops alike. And it's no wonder he shot that female. It was guaranteed to happen based on the postured ambiance in that area. When the media is continuously promoting fear, fear of death, fear of dying, everybody gets trigger happy. Everybody gets trigger happy. And when you're told that it's a bad thing for black people to be on welfare, what is bad about it? It is not taking anything out of your mouth. When Donald Trump goes bankrupt, and he does quite often, he lays that across your back so that you could pay more taxes to make sure that Donald Trump never goes hungry. When Rick Perry wants more money, he uses CPS to take another child or a bunch of children into the child sex trafficking industry so that those children can grow up without a self, always seeking a self. They want to be good boys and good girls, and that is politics, polykratis. When these children are broken and raped and the self is removed from them and their ability to be their own authority, they rely on the state. Governor Pilot there ensures that reliance while he listens to the chief priests and elders. And he promotes the most egregious things upon humanity. I'm not pulling any of this stuff out of my butt. You can go to Dun & Bradstreet, search general counsel, that's Rick Perry. Department of Health and Human Services, that's Rick Perry. There's a whole bunch of them there. He's got a good thing going on. He's got a closed system of business, and him and Joseph Biden and Patrick Leahy really like preying on your children. They love the income, they love the revenue, they love the dividends, they love the trade. They love it when you think that Israel's a country and that human beings are fighting against each other rather than corporations killing human beings and blaming human beings in the action of Hegel. They love it when you're sidelined and your attention is elsewhere. Then you worry about Kim Kardashian and the housewives of whatever. They love it when you're busy defending your title when the school sends home a letter and says your child called somebody else a name today and we're going to take some action against this thing. And then you vilify your child and turn on them and listen to another authority tell you how to parent wherein you are not. They love it when you're diagnosed. They love it when your children are diagnosed. And every time you take them in to get them on Adderall or ADHD medication or diagnose them as autistic so they can castrate your children to prevent your lineage. Now, one of the treatments for autism is the chemical castration drug Lupron. And for those of you who are new, or for those of you who would like to say, conspiracy theory, excuse me, they are castrating, chemically castrating your children and selling it to you as a good thing. To all the females, they're selling you reproductive rights, the right to abortion. What you don't know is they're selling you, with that abortion, the guarantee that you're going to have breast cancer or another form of cancer after you do that to your body. Abortion rights is, of course, selling depopulation. Over 1 million abortions are performed in the United States Incorporated each and every year. Less than 1% of those abortions are due to rape, according to Guttmacher Institute. They sold you the concept that perhaps there's a bunch of rape victims, but it's Rick Perry, John Cornyn, Barbara Boxer, Dianne Feinstein raping them. Absolutely, absolutely deplorable. Great piece in the New York Times, newyorktimes.com. Ferguson, Missouri, Michael Brown and Darren Wilson, two paths to a fatal encounter. I need everybody to, it's a beautiful one because so often you're not seeing the back end of these stories. Now that child, the environment, the habitat, the quote, bad neighborhood, the one from beyond the tracks, there's one in every community because it's engineered that way. What's the definition of crime? What's the formula for crime? Disparity of the classes. So, how do you promote crime? Classify. We got to classify people. Is it that easy? Heck yeah, there's middle class, low class, upper crust. There's Mexicans, blacks, Africans. Greeks, Spaniards, there's all sorts of classification. Christians and Jews, females and males, feminists and masculines. It makes the world go round. And of course, that is how Jesus is crucified, by casting lots, taking up titles. You're not a good mother. Yes, I am. I'm a good mother. I put the most expensive shoes on my child and I have the best school. They go to private school. Wait a second. You are buying all of these things from the same ugly, filthy, dirty law merchant. Any other biology doesn't buy these things. So you get to see those animals in zoos. But in the corporate structure of the United States Incorporated, United States of America, you watch television, which is the same visual effect. And not only that, you're not realizing that you're watching yourself through a screen in a zoo, on a farm, as you are pit against each other, classified and dehumanized in the 8 stages of genocide. And if they sell you the concept that you are more important than your brother, well, it allows them to kill your brother. And if they teach your brother the same thing, you can be off just as quickly. It's a great business model. Very, very efficient. Very efficient. Nazi Germany was the efficient use of that concept. Feminism was first employed in Bolshevik Russia. And that's what allowed Nazi Germany to occur the way it did. Everybody hated females. They were so specialized. They were getting away with everything. No, they weren't. They were being used as a tool of politics by the same attorneys doing the same thing here. And here, I mean, globally. Bangladesh, they started posturing Bangladesh back in the 1980s. Everywhere else has the same education. Everywhere else is an up-and-coming third world country waiting for attorneys to raise it by concept. Everywhere else. It took a very, very swift turn in 1941 with the Atlantic Charter. giving Congress global governance. Everybody else, everywhere else, is under code and same laws as the United States Incorporated, United States of America, have been passing forever to maintain corporate welfare. Those documents, constitutions, and other articles, it's a long-running business model. Article 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. The title of the document is just something else in the book. It's a global book that's being written by scriptwriters, screenwriters, playwrights called Congress. That thing is your adversary. The children of that thing are called Barabbas. They're adhering to the corporate welfare structure. Pareto's rule. Based on the concept of envy. Pareto's rule only works on envy. You give somebody 20% of something, they're going to produce 80% of their energy into keeping it or getting more of it. I need. Instead of acting as the heir, being the sovereign state, then accepting less than 1% of the overall as a right or a benefit, and then you've been buying rights and benefits, and you've been buying time through court process, through the medical industry, you buy time, you're so fearful of death, you're buying time. And because you're buying time, you're killing yourself, because you're taking the prescription medications that guarantee your productivity. When you stop doing that, Babel falls. Merchants wail. Merchants, the ones who are selling you all of these concepts, all of this consensus reality. Everybody has to stop buying from these merchants, the law merchant, medical industry, psychological industry, criminal industry. Blaming your children. I've watched for so many years as, you know, years ago, my poor nephew, you know, his parents, they enjoyed marijuana use. So their son, of course, he took marijuana to school with them. However, the parents decided not to take responsibility for allowing their child, which is their parental authority in the first place, if they so wish. Apparently it wasn't harming him. But they rolled on him. And then everybody knows what happened next. Once that child is turned on and he's been so traumatized, and his father forsakes him, his mother forsakes him, he becomes so chaotic, seeking the self, wanting to make a name, wanting, needing. And then, of course, when it's found that he's further vilified because now he's got a record, might as well join the pack. And he ended up, you know, criminalizing. If I'm going to be called a criminal, I might as well fit the part. And that's all children. All children. When the school comes at you and blames you for sexual abuse, blames your husband for sexual abuse because your child is acting out, and you look at each other and you say, well, it must have been you. No, wait a second. You know each other. Does your husband sexually abuse? Does your wife sexually abuse? The answer is usually no. It doesn't stop there. Don't stop there. Don't say, whew, I didn't sexually abuse my children. You don't say that. You say, well, who the hell is sexually abusing my child? You don't turn on them. And then the children act out and they end up in the same hands. The juvenile justice industry. So the school is raping the children. Priests are raping the children. Then the children go into juvenile justice and they're further abused so horrifyingly. Rocco is a child. He was talking about being in Joliet as a teenager in front of their eyes. In front of their eyes, one of the other children was hung and killed in that prison setting. What does that do to children? It teaches them to not speak out about abuse. They're surrounded by a military force. And again, how do they get there? You're letting go of the children in exchange for titles. You're protecting your egos over your children. They are being sexually abused in an industrial setting across the board in these Hitler youth camps, juvenile justice centers, churches, daycare, after-school programs, and you're letting them go. You're pit against each other. You're pointing the finger at each other, and you're trading your children for drugs so you don't have to deal with day-to-day reality. Your only obligation as parents is to protect those children. You have no other function as a biological creature on this planet other than to protect your children. RT.com is reporting on the Ukraine situation. No green light to Red Cross. Russian aid convoy stuck at Ukraine border waiting for Kiev's nod. All of this political red tape supplied by the U.S. Incorporated and its mouthpiece, Putin. Yesterday I was seeing reports that half of those trucks were empty. Those aren't verified, of course. And in the last week, they've said, well, maybe it's a Trojan horse expedition. Maybe it is. Or maybe it's just a really good show, and your mind is put to the side elsewhere, and you're not realizing that 2, 3, 4 corporations are squeezing human beings and starving them to death by limiting resources. And when they're not doing this upon humanity, they're bombing human beings. And when they're not doing that upon humanity, they're raping them and slaughtering them through various legal processes, medical processes, psychological processes. From RT.com, the Red Cross has sent a formal request to Kiev to allow the Russian humanitarian aid to enter eastern Ukraine, but has so far received no answer, and the convoy has remained stuck on the border of the war-torn zone since August 14th. Why do they need humanitarian aid? There's a corporation sitting in their way. Why do they need humanitarian aid? A corporation put up some laws and built a fence around their property and then told them what they could afford to eat and do. Why is there need for humanitarian aid? Development, corporate development projects. When a corporation wants to expand, well, of course it needs land, and according to the 14th Amendment, it has more right to it than you do. According to the Attorney Oath, 12 U.S.C. subsection 73, they're not hypothecated. You are. Why do we need humanitarian aid? United States Incorporated and the United Nations development projects of you said. And of course, everybody's beloved JFK. We don't want to talk bad about JFK. Wait a second. JFK is the one who introduced humanity to development and the need to constantly defend yourself from being raised, raped, and confiscated by attorneys. Well, why would anybody do that? Well, that's how business works. If you've got the forte and you have the patriotism, you can do just about anything, can't you? You can rape African children and get away with it because white folks, they don't care. Whew, thank God that wasn't me. Thank God that was happening in Africa and those children are starving in Africa. And that's not me. Oh, thank God. I don't know what I'd do if it was me. As it is, I've already got a divorce going on, and I just got laid off from my federal employment, and the IRS is coming after me. And the other day, somebody hotlined adult protection, and it's just, man, I'm strapped. Every one of those things is created by attorneys. Starvation, famine, floods, droughts, power outages, water restrictions. It's all to make you productive. Oh my God, white cops just killed a black child. Wait a second. It was corporate counsel that put them there in the first place and then festered. The media. They were using the media to dehumanize, desensitize the globe to itself and each other. I mean, it's just so sick. So sick. Those Amish are creepy. Those Baptists are sick down there. Hillsboro Baptist Church is a CIA presentation. FBI, those are federal agents. Well, God hates fags. No. Nope. 1 Corinthians 6 says you can only fornicate by giving your body to the Lord, God of it. Well, what does that mean? Well, if you make yourself a slave to another, that's fornication. What about faggots? There's no such thing. It's a what they call a cigarette in England, fag. What about all this other conflict and controversy? Well, it makes attorneys a pretty good living. Makes attorneys a really good living. Man, it's just something else that all these politicians coming in. David Axelrod defends Rick Perry, calls him diamond. Well, pretty sketchy. Yeah. Missouri governor declares emergency and imposes curfew in Ferguson. No, I want everybody's eyes on Ferguson, Missouri, immediately. This is being reported out of the New York Times, NewYorkTimes.com. Missouri governor declares emergency in Ferguson and orders nightly curfew. Ferguson, Missouri, after a week of unrest following the fatal shooting of a black teenager by a police officer, Governor Jay Nixon of Missouri on Saturday declared a state of emergency in Ferguson and ordered a curfew. Quote, "We will not allow a handful of looters to endanger the rest of this community," Governor Nixon said at a news conference in Ferguson. Quote, "If we're going to achieve justice, we must first have and maintain peace." Peace stems from the word pax, meaning pact. This governor out there is shutting down Missouri and their perpetual protection of the local corporate counsel, general counsel. And they got some paid thugs to loot the local business by which to promote fear. And in this, fear creates patriotism. When you feel that you cannot be your own authority, when you feel that you are unable to protect yourself, you automatically fall back on what is known as cognitive dissonance, the easiest to believe truth, or the easier way. And they says, well, I'm just going to rely on Mr. What's his name there, Governor Jay Nixon. Well, wait a second. Throughout this week, I've seen bad officers and I've seen really good officers. I've seen humanity come together and I've seen FBI agents now pitting them apart, parting them out. Looting a store is not harm on a human being. This is a presentation. This is a presentation. And an 18-year-old child was murdered by an officer directed by another. Now, they never expected this to go this far. None of them did. None of them did, because humanity has been sleeping for a very long time. About a month ago, they admitted to putting lithium in the water as they were testing it to see if it's working, making human beings compliant. And this is not just in the United States Incorporated. They were speaking about Scotland and the UK as well. Everyone needs to filter their water. And of course, I don't like to advertise, but I like a good carbon filter, such as the Berkey. It does filter out many different particles, and there are others that are even, you know, more superior, but you need to be filtering your water and making sure that there are no drugs in it so that you can stay awake. No more sleeping. Watch what you're eating according to the FDA food pyramid, of course. The preservatives in foods, sodium benzoate, calcium benzoate, potassium benzoate is found in almost every condiment and salad dressing, things like this. You need to check up them, because as that metabolizes, it turns directly into benzodiazepines, which are bennies, benzoates, Valium, Xanax. And the more you consume of these things, the greater concentration you have of these very, very lethal medications. Prescriptions. Before writing. So writing before you are. Those are not side effects. They're benefits for a corporation. Islamist extremists kill scores of Yazidi men in Iraq. Airstrikes target nation's largest dam. And of course, Islamic extremists, the informant came out in 2012 and said there's no hunt. It's all fixed. There's no hunt. The FBI is the extremists. The Islamic extremists, the Christian extremists, the Jew extremists. Hillsborough Baptist Church, that kind of extremism that doesn't exist in humanity. I mean, human beings do not behave in those manners. These things are all presentations. They're all play acts. They're all posturing so that Congress can cash in on your demise. The level of predation is intellectual. It is not... intellectually, it's just like a trapdoor spider. If you look at the hunting techniques of a trapdoor spider, and it digs a hole and then it leaves a little thing hanging there so that the victim is attracted to the hole. Isn't that the Department of Health and Human Services, CPS, Adult Protection, and everything else that's sold to you in your own garden? From that tree of knowledge, IRS, they're hunting tools of hunting. Each one offers you a nice little benefit to rat out each other, to turn on each other, to go into their clutches, to enter into their cords, to enter into their homes. And all they're there for is human trafficking and genocide. All of these nice little hunting tools and techniques. Sociology calls it sticks and carrots in the action of procurement. We're at the break, folks. Be right back in a moment. Stick around. And welcome back to the second hour of Leaving the Farm right here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps. We are a listener-supported radio station. And if you'd like to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages. We're also simulcasting on No Borders Radio at noborderradio.co.uk in the UK, as well as tammypepperman.org if you would like to donate, tammypepperman.org, No Borders, as well as tamworthwebdevelopment.co.uk. Please do so by going to tammypepperman.org. clicking on our donate buttons or over on Tamworth site. It's amazing. The products that they're coming out with are just absolutely amazing. When you go there, you're going to find a new, it's hard to explain. Go to tamworthwebdevelopment.co.uk and view what they have to offer. Their website products are just astounding. I love the last one. From the NewYorkTimes.com, using a tactic unseen in a century, countries cordon off Ebola racked areas. The Ebola outbreak in West Africa is so out of control that governments there revived a disease-fighting tactic not used in nearly a century. The cordon sanitaire, in which a line is drawn around the affected area, no one is allowed out. Cordons, common in the medieval era of the Black Death, have not been seen since the border between Poland and Russia was closed in 1918 to stop typhus from spreading west. They have the potential to become brutal and inhumane. Centuries ago, in their most extreme form, everyone within the boundaries was left to die or survive until the outbreak ended. Plans for the new cordon were announced on August 1st at an emergency meeting in Conakry, Guinea, the Mano River Union, a regional association of Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia, the three countries hardest hit by Ebola, according to Agence France-Presse. The plan was to isolate a triangular area where the three countries meet, separated only by porous borders and where 70% of the cases known at that time had been found. Troops began closing internal roads in Liberia and Sierra Leone last week. The epidemic began in southern Guinea in December, but new cases there have slowed to a trickle. In the two other countries, the number of new cases is still rapidly rising. As of Monday, the region had seen 1,848 cases and 1,013 deaths, according to the World Health Organization, although many experts think that the real count is much higher because families in remote villages are avoiding hospitals and hiding victims. Officials at the Health Organization and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which have experts advising the countries, say the tactic could help contain the outbreak, but want to see it used humanely. Quote, it might work, said Dr. Martin S. Citron, the disease center's chief quarantine expert. Quote, but it has a lot of potential to go poorly if it's not done with an ethical approach. Just letting the disease burn out and considering that the price of controlling it, we don't live in that area anymore. And as soon as cases are under control, one should dial back the restrictions, end quote. Experts said that any cordon must be food, water, and medical care reach those inside, and that the trust of inhabitants must be won through communication with their leaders. The phrase cordon sanitaire, sanitary barrier appears to date from 1821, when France sent 30,000 troops into the Pyrenees to stop a lethal fever raging in Spain from crossing the border. In Sierra Leone, large sections of the Calhoun and Kanema districts, an area the size of Jamaica, have been cut off by military roadblocks. Soldiers check the credentials and take the temperatures of those trying to go in or out. In Liberia, similar restrictions have been imposed north of the capital, Monrovia. Terrible, terrible stuff. Terrible. From Slate.com, policing the police, training, retraining, and yet more training are not the way to stop police brutality. In just the last 2 months, Michael Brown, 18, was killed by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. Azel Ford, 25, was killed by a police officer in Los Angeles. Frank Alvarado, 39, was killed by a Salinas police officer. Eric Garner, 43, was killed by a New York police officer. And Marlene Pinnock, 51, was brutally beaten by a California Highway Patrol officer. All of these victims were of color and all were unarmed. Since these latest incidents, there's been much talk about the need for retraining officers, and there have been repeated calls from an outraged public for investigations by the U.S. Department of Justice and the FBI. But training and federal investigations are ineffective responses to allegations of police misconduct. We know how to solve this epidemic. We just need to find the political will to do it. Before they even don their uniforms, police officers receive hours and hours of training about their appropriate use of force. At the nation's police academies, they learn how to evaluate situations where force could be an option and when it's illegal. By the time officers are patrol ready, they know how to use their firearms, batons, and stun guns. Yet in response to the chokehold killing of Eric Garner, New York Police Commissioner William Bratton has called for the retraining of his officers. Training is, of course, essential to law enforcement, but it would be a serious and dangerous error to shrug off these deaths and beatings by cops and simply attribute them to inadequate training. It's not. They're trained in the use of protocol given situation. So for example, the SWAT team. If corporate counsel directs through dispatch to a SWAT team and it says, there's a war, there's an impending war at this house, you're gonna encounter armed to the teeth individuals, follow protocol. So SWAT team shows up at that house, throws a shot grenade into the house, into a crib of a baby, while everybody's sleeping. And the cops, just following protocol, just took directives from corporate counsel to do that to a child without being told that there was a child in that location and that they were not encountering what they would normally see in Iraq. Now, we need to get to the heart of the matter because law enforcement and citizens are being slaughtered recklessly by corporate counsel, balls to the wall, gung-ho on genocide. Now, this is absolutely abhorrent to watch as law enforcement is being vilified day after day after day after day when it's corporate counsel directing them. Now, these folks, they're from single mother households. They're from places that have been torn apart by a tyranny already. They join the military because they're looking for a father figure. They're being patriotic to the state. They join law enforcement looking for a father, someone to be proud of them, someone to look up to only find predation in the state. These law enforcement officers go to law enforcement schools, police academies, to protect humanity, to make their father proud. And when their father is directing this kind of nonsense, it is absolutely no longer to be tolerated. These are the same babies that you look in the eyes of each and every day. Well, no, Tammy, it's cops are vilified in the media. Yes, they've been vilified in the media for that reason. Guess what happened when we got around attorneys? Now, everybody who's listened to us in the past and all of the audios, all of this is on our various channels, Revolution Radio, Bono's Entertainment, Tammy K32. The entire walk is there. When I first started out, of course, I would think, you know, years and years ago, calling the cops, that you were getting cops. No, you go through dispatch, psychiatry, corporate counsel, and you never are reaching the ears of law enforcement. Ever. And to evidence this, of course, 2 years ago, I volunteered to be a guinea pig. And we're facing eviction, unlawful eviction. And of course, volunteering. You know, I'm calling around to the local sheriff and I'm like, hello, but the judge is acting quite like a banker and the attorneys are acting like bankers. And I never once got a hold of the attorney or the sheriff. And due to the requirements, we required to serve the sheriff, and that never reached the sheriff either. That only reached the attorneys. So my voice was never heard by law enforcement for the longest time until I realized what was going on. Then I started contacting them back channel, and sure enough, they were just like me. Identical to me. They were not monsters. They were not boogeyman. Law enforcement is in law enforcement because they have empathy. Agents, on the other hand, now agents are usually psychopathic. They have no empathy. They're missing the frontal lobe, and they work for attorneys. They're a military force. Now law enforcement. So we go along, and we're like, okay, what do you want to know this time? And we volunteered time and time and time again, and we showed law enforcement, hey, look, now if I go this way, the attorney preys on me that way. And if I do this, the attorney preys on me here. And if I do this, the attorney preys on me here. And ultimately, we were able to evidence actual genocide perpetrated by the medical industry, not once, not twice, but three times in front of the eyes of law enforcement, actual law enforcement, without attorneys being involved. And in between, of course, we evidenced to law enforcement, the dispatch worked on behalf of the corporate counsel, and they had them in their ears. And then we found out that this dispatch had an even lower IQ than law enforcement was required to have. So dispatch was basically a speaker for corporate counsel. Poor dispatch had their head filled up with all sorts of indoctrination. And sadly, they are the first to go. After we evidence these things, of course, the most ironic thing happened, and I bumped into the local dispatch that I had originally dealt with and never met. She got blacklisted because all of a sudden her eyes are opened. And she's like, wait a second here. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Oh my goodness. You guys suck. And poof, magically, she lost her job. And of course, this is all happening in like 2012, the first part of 2013. And after a year of being fired from her former employment and looking for jobs and trying her best to survive, lo and behold, just one moment, folks, she's been blackballed. Hello? Sorry about that, folks. Looked like I was the recipient of a butt dial. Somebody on the other end was speaking to somebody else and it was very muffled, so interesting. Well, and again, in front of law enforcement, we're talking about the use of ERISA, the Employee Retirement Insurance Securities Act, by which to raise humanity. You know, I give Jeff Herbs as an example often because that was one of the experiences. Then we start having law enforcement and jailers coming out of the woodwork and saying, oh my goodness, ERISA was used on me too. ERISA is used on me too. I got a divorce. She cleaned me out. Now I'm facing retirement and they won't let me have anything. Well, no, because upon a quadro, when you got the divorce, that retirement, the whole entire trust went into the local judge's coffers. It's under ERISA, the trustees, and the judge. So, according to hedge funds and insurance on that bet, You're likely to be off real soon. Well, boy, oh boy, what I learned from that experience is that law enforcement does not like being a victim of genocide either. Then we went along, and of course, we're talking to law enforcement, and then all of a sudden, law enforcement is speaking like an attorney. I'm like, excuse me, but you're being indoctrinated. And law enforcement steps back for a minute, and it says, well, I don't know, I really like that attorney over there. And I saw it again, and I'm like, excuse me, but you're arguing the practice of law, so whatever attorney is talking to you, you might want to get away from them, because that's all consensus reality and not what's really going on here. Law enforcement, of course, stepped back for a minute, and it said, well, oh, man, these attorneys suck. Then, of course, right after that, we had some red tape through the insurance company now. And the insurance is all, at first, the insurance company didn't want to listen until I went over their heads. And they're like, nope, never heard of you. Wait a second, it's been 21 days. I don't want to time this out, blah, blah, blah. Nope, never heard of you before in my life. And I've got answer me to messages on my phone still from insurance calling me back, dealing with me regarding these matters. And then all of a sudden everything just stops and everything disappears. And I'm like, oh boy, oh boy. Thank goodness I sent everything to them and their handlers at the same time. And their handlers finally saw what was going on, because this is just absolutely profound. This is absolutely profound. Jeff Erbs is a victim of fourth generation warfare. His son's been murdered and hung in his garage on Father's Day. His ex-wife kicks him in the teeth just after that. And lo and behold, she's a specialized female with gas and oil rights. And the local judge is a member of the United Way, which is mainly funded through gas and oil. And then delving into it a little bit more, we found out that that judge is Stephen Cray of Cray Computers. And he's just making sure that his corporate interests are protected over the human being that he's got watch over. And it was then that I went back to 1 Corinthians 6 and I, oh, that's what that meant. Judges are Satan and fornication is entering into their courts and all their crap games, and I'll be darned, I found Satan, Beelzebub, Barabbas, Governor Pilate there. This has just been a very profound walk. Always walked us to 1 Corinthians 13. I don't know why, you know, in the beginning, why I chose that route. I mean, I love the truth, and I'm sure that has everything to do with it, of course. But it's been a very profound journey. In the BBC.com today, police complain over Sir Cliff Richard search leak. South Yorkshire police have complained to the BBC after the broadcaster gained details of a search the force was planning to conduct at pop star Sir Cliff Richard's home. Officers carried out the search in Sunningdale, Berkshire, on Thursday. The force says the BBC broke its own editorial rules. The BBC says normal journalistic practice was followed. Sir Cliff, 73, said the allegation of an historical sex offense against a boy under 16 is, quote, completely false. BBC cameras and a reporter were outside the gates to Sir Cliff's property when 8 police officers arrived. In a statement, South Yorkshire police said it was contacted some weeks ago by a BBC reporter who made it clear he knew of the existence of an investigation. It was clear he was in a position to publish it. Quote, the force was reluctant to cooperate, but felt that to do otherwise would risk losing any potential evidence. So in the interest of the investigation, it was agreed that the reporter would be notified of the date of the house search in return for delaying publication of any of the facts, end quote. Police later said a number of people had provided information after the search, although it did not say what this was related to. In a statement, South Yorkshire Police added that, contrary to media reports, the decision to involve the BBC was not taken in order to maximize publicity. It was taken to preserve any potential evidence. Jonathan Munro, the BBC's head of news gathering, wrote on Twitter on Friday that South Yorkshire Police had not been the source of the story. The South Yorkshire Police said it was disappointing that the BBC was slow to acknowledge that the force was not the source of the leak. It said a letter of complaint had been sent to the Director General of the BBC, making it clear that the broadcaster appeared to have contravened its own editorial guidelines. A BBC's, quote, South Yorkshire Police would become an investigation into the original leak, end quote, it added. A BBC spokesman said a BBC journalist approached South Yorkshire Police with information about the investigation. The BBC agreed to follow normal journalistic practice and not to publish a story that might jeopardize a police inquiry. The BBC understands the allegation against Sir Cliff relates to an alleged assault at an event featuring U.S. preacher Billy Graham at Bramall Lane in Sheffield in 1985. Sir Cliff responded to the police search in a statement which said, for many months I have been aware of allegations against me of historic impropriety which have been circulating online. Quote, the allegations are completely false. Up until now I have chosen not to dignify the false allegations with a response that it would just give them more oxygen, end quote. He said he would, quote, cooperate fully, end quote, if the police wanted to speak to him. Evidence is evidence is evidence is evidence. The media is to be reporting to preserve the well-being of humankind. We're not going to play tit-for-tat games. We're not going to play these games. Sick, perverted. Those are attorney games. We don't need any of that. I want everybody held accountable for their works against the children. From TheEconomist.com, Edward Campos. Edward Campos, Brazilian politician and presidential candidate, died on August 13th, aged 49. What stayed with you after meeting Edward Campos were his eyes, bright and penetrating. They seemed to change color between blue, green, and gray. He was a striking man in other ways, too, tall and dashing, dressed in a dark suit of blazer, his black hair flecked with gray and slicked back above a high forehead, aquiline nose, a prominent cleft chin. Like many Brazilian politicians, he was tactile, putting his hand on his knee or forearm to emphasize a point, but unlike some, he always seemed cool and contained, even in the dripping heat of his home state of Pernambuco in Brazil's northeast. Sad to see the loss of anyone. Of course, Edward Campos died on August 13, age 49, it was a plane accident. Terrible. Terrible, terrible. Sorry about that, folks. Going forward here. Church launches bitter attack on PM's incoherent Middle East policy. BBC News UK. About an hour ago, tomorrow's paper, you might want to pick that up. It's interesting, all of these political plays, especially by, you know, priests and others that are, you know, gung-ho on, you know, corporate welfare, maintaining that corporate welfare. We don't need any of that anymore. And, the priest to be involved in pitting humanity, that is evidence of terrorism. It is evidence of promoting civil war. And your insurance does not cover that, of course, in relation to such as cover hold and other things. And I guess I wish you luck in your endeavors. You're going to need it. Always been interesting ever since I was little, even as a child, you know, to see the Pope and others like him traveling around in bulletproof glass with armed guards and then promoting a faith in God. Yes, I trust in God. Okay, why are you with bulletproof glass and armed guards of course, children under your robes. And it's always been profound. I've always abhorred violence. I don't like violence. And it's just ironic to me, very ironic to me, to see these that call themselves faithful servants, trusting God, that they would walk around armed to the teeth. Wall Street Journal's reporting FBI sent 40 agents to Ferguson to investigate police-involved shooting of Michael Brown, official says. Find that on the Wall Street Journal. Missouri governor declares state of emergency curfew for Ferguson. And, of course, human beings do not need a curfew. Law enforcement, if they're a threat to humanity, needs to be removed from the ability to enforce corporate policy. Start there. And then give everybody a psych eval and find out if they're a psychopath. Quick and easy. And maybe some x-rays and find out if they've got a frontal lobe or if they're just basically what equates to robots. And find that those 40 FBI agents are trained to be robots, Quantico, and to be the military force for attorneys. U.S. says it carried out 9 airstrikes, hitting targets near Erbil and Mosul Dam in northern Iraq, according to the BBC News World. Woman improves after unknowingly drinking iced tea laced with industrial cleaning solution at Utah restaurant. Associated Press is reporting that she's doing better. That was absolutely horrifying. Apparently, an employee of the restaurant added powdered white lye to the iced tea rather than sugar. However, when the investigation was maintained in the building, everything is labeled according to what it is. And I wonder what's going on behind the scenes, if that was an accident or not. It's interesting. All of these selfies is... They're news... relative to ramen noodles. Now, it's quite interesting. Famed pathologist Michael Badden to conduct second autopsy on body of Missouri teen. Michael Badden, of course, has been an actor. I think he had a program on HBO, something like that, years ago. Maybe Cinemax. Don't remember. But it's interesting, the concepts that he presents. Now, when they whacked George Sinkhan, they said he went up into the Georgia mountains and buried himself and then shot himself in the head to explain to the ME why his body was already decomposing and it already had, evidence on it that it was already buried before the supposed shooting of his wife and her friend happened, by which to raise his estate. Of course, 2 children were left without parents. And this is back in 2009. Again, I think it was 2013 or 2012 when I read a media piece about his estate. And the attorneys had pit the family members to the extent that George Zinkhan's estate was completely dry and bled out by the attorneys fighting over those children, which is, of course, the reason they killed him in the first place. George Zinkhan was teaching compulsive behavior at the University of Georgia. He was teaching people why you feel compelled to do what you do, and especially his work on marketing techniques. You know, the reason that milk is put in the back of the store, for example, because it's been sold as a staple product in the United States, and the eggs are the same. Eggs are in the back of the store, milk and bread. And if that's the case, then throughout your journey through the store, you're more guaranteed to purchase more items that you don't necessarily need. However, they catch your attention. And very, very, very absolutely mandatory reading for anyone who wants to learn about the psychological experimentation on human beings and how efficient a business model that is for the United States of America style or chain of events. Merely congressional actions according to market condition. Market conditions are created by attorney, of course, IMF, fourth generation warfare, low intensity conflict, winning hearts and minds, and all of these war devices, tools, and techniques. And in that, it moves humanity. It pushes you along. It pulls you along. Statutes, for example, or statements of compulsion, they pull you along. You don't want to do that because, you know, civil forfeiture. Instead of asking what's civil forfeiture, this appears to be a lot like piracy. And let me explain to you what Baalism is. And it sounds to me like you're worshiping Marduk. No, I'm not worshiping Marduk. I'm following policy. No, it's the same thing. So let's just get to the foundation here, because you corporations are in the action of piracy, and your law enforcement is called privateers, and they're going out and capturing other vessels and bringing them in front of your courts for condemnation and sale. And that seems to me also defined as human trafficking, and that's also defined as genocide when you're targeting a specific race, which of course refers to the human being. Now, all of these things and these presentations and their unlawful acts are in their own hand. If you want evidence of the criminal activity of the United States Congress, read their acts. The evidence is in the acts themselves, not just in their works and actions on the other end, but the acts, the presentation itself, the intent, the knowledge, the studies. There's nothing that's not written, and they keep a running written account because they want to see what is more efficient or less efficient or detrimental to the current policy or beneficial to the current policy. And all of these laws that they create and maintain, they didn't ever create them. They're psychological constructs, first and foremost. That is what the tree of knowledge is. Second part of that is what is shutting up your kingdom. And if you want to talk about who is shutting up your kingdom, why, it's called a lawmaker. These things are, everything is written. When they employ a specific model upon the populace, they study it and its behavior, how efficient it is, where it goes, how it's doing, and then they'll incorporate. That's a very important word for everybody to realize, because the constitutions, the Articles of Confederacy, those are all articles of incorporation. So as the corporation goes along, it incorporates different sets into itself or different uses of political tools like feminism and masculism. Females now have the right to vote. Wait a second, we took their right in the first place. Those are market conditions. If you take the female's right to vote, or they believe that you did, well, then they want to fight to get back their right. They don't realize that, hold on a second, that's a concept. You're buying a concept. What are you voting for? That thing is horrifying. It's Satan. Don't vote for it. But you do because you want the right to vote. You think that you deserve that above everything else. Wait a second. They stole your authority and then they sold you the right to vote. Feminism is a political tool. Feminism is a political tool. And the male, after you're sold all of these things to the female, the male looks over and sees that you have more rights than he has, not realizing that he's being raised by the same lawmakers and legal process as is raising you, but you look at each other and you hate each other because these attorneys have pit you against it, yourselves and each other and offered you a greener pasture, usually in the form of an agent. So your wife is running off with an FBI agent or your husband has run off with an FBI agent. And they don't have to be trained at Quantico. They're trained in business intelligence and they're trained at Arizona University, Phoenix University and things like that, where they're trained to be your adversary. That's what makes the world go round, your adversary. Everybody has to be in controversy. That allows these attorneys to pick you up as lost things on the river of Styx. Well, they hate each other. Yay! Well, wait a second, why do you clap when they hate each other? Well, that means that if everybody hates each other, everybody, every human being on this planet is on the edge of the herd. That is the ultimate hunting technique. It's divide and conquer. Don't be divided. That's what Jesus said over and over and over again. 1 Corinthians 13 says it's not going to be perfect until everything that's parted is not parted anymore. And that which is perfect is come, and that which is parted is done away. That means if you're still parted, well, you're not perfect. So what's perfect? The whole, the being, the unparted thing, the unparted everything, the beginning and the end at the same time, the Alpha and the Omega, without any resistance, without any Om shutting up its kingdom. That is when perfection is, and it's defined. Perfection is when nothing is parted out. They sold you the other stuff. Put on this kind of shirt and put on these tits today and put on this butt today and put on this hat and put on these glasses, put on this lipstick, put on this collar, put on this culture, put on this language, wear this. You look better in that language. You look better, way, way better in that culture because, you know, you've got really good etiquette. Who told you you were naked to sell you those things? It's the same lawmaker. Same attorney, same Satan, same house of Beelzebub, the lord of the flies that consume and consume and consume. That's Cain. That is Cain, Eve's children. Eve, consuming from the tree of knowledge, she's teaching her children to consume and consume, and eventually those children become what is known as the consumptive good. Consumer behavior, consumer society. That increases, of course, what? Stock and the stock market. That increases sales. That increases consumption. And as those things increase, the attorney pocket gets fatter and fatter and fatter and fatter. And Eve's children cannibalize each other. Well, what does that mean? Well, if you're taught to only love each other for a reward, you are cannibalizing another individual, another human being. What can you do for me? If I do that for you, what will you do for me? If I do that, what do I get? That is not living. That is consuming another. Jesus said, just be. Protect each other. Your reward comes after that. Well, how does that happen? Well, you protect each other and you're no longer parted out. You get everything. How is that? Well, there's no controversy. What do you mean? If you love each other and you are whole and you're no longer parted out, and yet the psychopath is still parted out, you have everything. You have everything. But if you're parted out, you have nothing. Your house is left desolate unto you. Everything is gone because you're seeking whatever it is you're seeking, but it sure as heck isn't reality. And chasing that cartoon is what enters everything into bankruptcy. If you're chasing a cartoon and you're observing a cartoon and patronizing a cartoon or fictional father, those demi pseudo gods, Marduk and friends, Beelzebub, Satan, and Barabbas, psychiatry, when you're buying concepts, you're not living in reality. You're not acting as a real being. You're acting as a fiction, seeking to be. I want it. I want to be. I need that. I need to be. Wait a second. You already are. You are the authority. You already exist. You are the authority. Corporation is a concept. Attorneys are fictional beings that turn you against each other. They are your adversary. And they're saying that they own the banks, they own the corporations, because they sit on those boards and they pass down code to you so that you can maintain corporate welfare. Living as a fiction is very painful, because living as that fiction, you become Job. That is the story of Job. And they, the attorneys, general counsel, and their cronies, they raise your house to the ground, and then you are happy to produce for them to rebuild it again, earning the right to be. And then they burn it down another way through the medical industry or psychological or criminal industry, and you're happy to be, because at the other end of your raising, you have something else this time. But it is nothing. And Job did that over and over and over again. And ultimately, in the end, the church stepped in and gave him some money and made him forget about all of the raising. How is that helpful to Job? How is that humane? How is that in any way, shape, or form good for children? It is not. You cannot throw money at it and take away genocide. That doesn't work. I don't want to witness another genocide. So Barabbas is going to be held accountable. We're not going to accept genocide because somebody threw money at it. We're not going to accept pedophilia because somebody threw money at it. You cannot purchase my children. My children are not for sale. We're not going to play these games anymore. Humanity is going to be at its well-being. It is not going to be subject to a corporation, corporate governance, policy, or agenda. Before Ebola, Liberia had 51 doctors for 4 million people without basic hospital supplies. Many doctors are dying, according to the Wall Street Journal 2 hours ago. Sorry about this, folks. I haven't updated in the last few minutes, of course. RT is reporting once again, Germany tapped John Kerry's phone, spied on Turkey for years, report. It's a cool headline. Merkel, of course, works for the United States Incorporated. There was a deal cut back in 48. I'll have to get that up on TammyPepperman.org, or I'll put it on the more information section when I get the video up. But it's very interesting to see these presentations as they point fingers at each other. Merkel in Germany as a corporation, sitting in Washington, D.C., the Federal Republic of Germany, and it's Congress. Sovna Brunei makes bid for New York's Plaza Hotel, London's Grosvenor House, and Lower Manhattan's Dream Hotel. That's interesting. Sovna Brunei, I'll have to look more into that. A lot of moon and star pictures this week. I really like those, the Perseids and the full moon, but I, you know, this has been interesting to see the weather patterns that are occurring across the globe. It's interesting. Very, very interesting. 10,000 protests in Tel Aviv for just peace and to occupation is being reported by, it looks like RT. Again, so many things happening. And, you know, again, we need to all be together. Everybody needs to come together and realize that, no, if you don't do anything right now about the Stasi agents in your backyard, Nazi Germany occurs all over again. You know, this thing in Ferguson is very interesting to see, because it's basically mainstream America. And if you allow another authority into your community and you end up with curfews and a babysitter, and you enjoy these things, gets worse. Gets worse and worse due to urban pacification. Now, this child, 18-year-old, wasn't killed by a citizen. Well, everybody, see you next week.